Welcome to the EPG Padashala, the lecture series in computer science for the postgraduate program. This is the compiler design course and we are on module 39, where we will be discussing the loop transformations, loop optimization, as well as aliases. To understand the additional loop optimization, which is in addition to what was discussed in the earlier module, and to understand to deal with aliases in the context of pointers and assignments involving pointers. So, the previous module discussed loop invariant computation as well as code motion. So, we have to be ensuring that code motion does not result in illegal code motion, should be a valid one. And in continuation with that, we will discuss what is called as the induction variable elimination. So, a variable x is supposed to be an induction variable if every time the value of x is changed by a constant c, it could be a plus constant or a minus constant. So, this is called as a basic induction variable. So, look for the basic induction variable where I can be written as I plus or minus a constant c. Now, this is what we call as a basic induction variable. Now, I can also have what is called as a derived induction variable, where the value of j, supposing I can call j as a derived induction variable, if the value of j is defined in terms of the basic induction variable I, that is, I can say j is equal to I plus or minus some c. Okay? So, the typical thing is I will indicate j as I into c plus d, that is, I will be talked about in terms of a multiplicative constant c, and then I can also add it with an offset. Okay? So, that is typically what is called as a derived induction variable. Again, every time I changes, j will also change. So, j is also called as a induction variable only, but it is called as a derived induction variable. Now, to identify this, so the first step will be to identify the induction variable. Second thing will be to get rid of this induction variable by means of what is called as strength reduction. So, these two will go hand in hand. Similarly, the earlier one, like loop invariant as well as code motion, will go hand in hand. So, the first step in the induction variable elimination algorithm is to identify the induction variable. So, the algorithm will be a loop L with reaching definitions and loop invariant computation. So, this is a definition that has been reached, a particular statement. So, this can be done using a data flow analysis algorithm. And we have also identified statements which are going to be loop invariant. That is also available here. So, things which are not loop invariant, which are loop variant, will basically be looked upon for induction variable. So, we know that given a loop L, certain statements are loop invariant and certain will be loop variant. So, loop variant will be considered for identifying the induction variables. So, output will be a set of induction variables, basic as well as the derived induction variables. That will be the output. So, how will the algorithm go is, find the basic induction variable based on the loop invariant computation. So, that is what I have just now said. So, you can look at statements which are not loop invariant, that is loop variant will be identified. Call it as the basic induction variable I. So, search for a variable k having the following forms: k is equal to j into b, k is equal to b into j, or k is equal to j by b, j plus or minus b, or k is equal to b plus or minus j. So, where b is typically a constant, k is a derived variable and j is an induction variable. J is a basic induction variable or an already computed derived induction variable, that can be also be j. So, after identifying that, you can compute or you write the triple for k as j comma b comma 0. Now, why is it j comma b comma 0 is, if you could see, I am looking at j, k is equal to j into b, right? Or b into j or j by b. So, I can express k in terms of j and b, and there is an offset of 0 here, that is what we call it, and compute the triple and accumulate to the list of all the induction variables. This is what we do, and modify them to use additions or subtractions as against multiplication or division. After doing this, we can replace the costlier operation by cheaper one and vice versa. So, that is normally called as strength reduction. So, you have to first identify induction variables, be it basic or derived. Now, after identifying induction variables, the next thing which we normally perform is called as strength reduction. Now, strength reduction is input will be a loop L with reaching definitions and induction variable computed, and the output will be again a revised loop. So here, for each induction variable I, in turn, for every induction variable j in the family of I with a triple I comma c comma d, so this is j's representation, where j is equal to I into c plus d. So you, for everything you have to do this, create a new variable s, replace the assignment to j by j is equal to s. So wherever RHS is there, you replace that as j is equal to s, and immediately after the assignment, I is equal to I plus n, append c is s is equal to s plus c into n. So whatever was done here, I am simply copying it with respect to this, because j is equal to I into c plus d. I am repeating the same thing here, but I am replacing j with s. Okay. After that, place s in the family of I with a triple I comma c comma d, and s is initialized to c into I plus d. That is, s is equal to c into I and s is equal to s plus d. So whatever was done here, I am breaking this into two components, where I can call the c into n as one particular value and then adding that with s. So s is equal to c into n, that is what I am calling it as c into I here, and s is equal to s plus d. Now this is the c into I can basically be moved elsewhere, so that I can simply increment this with only in terms of s itself. Okay, so that is the algorithm, and now this is what we have already known as the quicksort algorithm, which we have considered for optimization. So blocks B2 and B3 are classic examples of induction variable elimination as well as strength reduction. So we know that I compute a value 4 into I here, and this I gets changed frequently. Similarly, I compute a value called as 4 into j here, where this value of j also gets changed frequently. So j is a induction variable here and I is an induction variable here. Now T2 and T4 are also derived induction variables, which is based on I and j respectively. So I have to get rid of them. That is what we are trying to aim at. Now B2 and B3 are inner loops. Okay. So the induction variable is B3 is j, and T4 is defined as j comma 4 comma 0. Similarly, for B2, it's I, and T4 is defined in terms of I comma 4 comma 0. So if, for B2, you create a variable called as T2. So T4 is equal to 4 into j is replaced with T4 is equal to S4. This is what we do, and insert the assignment S4 is equal to S4 minus 4 after j is equal to j minus 1. This is the algorithmic step. So we compute S4 is equal to S4 minus 4, and it is inserted after j is equal to j minus 1. So here, after this statement, I insert S4 is equal to S4 minus 4, and I replace T4 is equal to S4 here. Okay. And then what do we do here? Similarly, for I is equal to I plus 1, I create a new variable called as S2, and I call this as S2 is equal to S2 plus 4, and T2 is equal to S2. Now, what happens is these two statements, S2 is equal to 4 into I and S4 is equal to 4 into j, need not be computed here. They become loop invariant. So I have to basically move this outside this particular block. So S2 and S4 are basically moved outside it. So I have also reduced strength here, where I have replaced multiplication with addition here. Okay. At this particular point, I need not use I at all, because I is not being used at all. Therefore, I becomes a dead code, and here j becomes a dead code. So in the process of removing induction variable and performing strength reduction, you might end up in a dead code as well. So dead code has to be also eliminated. So the next one will be elimination of induction variable. After this is the strength reduction step. Now my job here is to eliminate this induction variable I and j respectively. So for that, the next algorithm is a loop L with reaching definition information, loop invariant computation, and live variable information. So the live variable information is required, because I and j, is it going to be used later or not, we should know. Okay. So output will be a revised loop. So algorithm is, take some induction variable j in I's family with I comma c comma d, and modify each test that I appears in to use j instead. C is positive. So for example, if I relop x go to b is available, you convert this into r is equal to c into x R is equal to R plus D, and then convert this to, if J real of R, go to B. So you can basically convert this also. Now, supposing I have two variables, I1 and I2, both are induction. So for that, you compute two new variables as well, called as J1, J2. And then you delete the assignments to the eliminate induction variables from the loop L. So simply delete it. Consider every new statement J is equal to S, and verify that no assignment to S between the introduced statement and the use of J has got this value defined. So replace all uses of J by uses of S and delete J is equal to S. This is what we have to do. So here I have got rid of I is equal to I plus 1. I have also got rid of J is equal to J minus 1 here. And finally, I have replaced, we had a T4 is equal to S4 here, right? So that T4 is equal to S4 is of no use. So I can rename that, or I can rename S2 by T2 itself and S4 by T4 itself. Now, what is missing is we had an I greater than or equal to J check here, okay? That can be very well compared with S2 and S4 itself, because S2 and S4 is now going to be doing the job of the induction part. So I keep doing that and then come out of it. So this is what we have to look at. Now on to so loop optimization involves loop invariant computation that results in called as code motion, and then you identify the induction variables, perform strength reduction of induction variables if it is possible, and that will result in unnecessary statements. So you may have to eliminate the already existing induction variables. So that is what we have discussed so far. Now on to the next one, which is dealing with aliases. Okay, if two or more expressions denote the same memory address, we say that the expressions are aliases of one another. Okay, presence of pointers makes data flow analysis more complex, because they will result in alias statement, and a pointer P can point to some statement. It is to assume that an indirect assignment through a pointer can potentially change any variable. So I can say I can define a pointer and then change the value of the variable using the pointer basically. So that is also possible. So that is an indirect assignment, can basically change the value of a variable. So you have to look at that concept and ensure that aliases doesn't change, or at least make sure that the aliases exist, and we have to be watching on those aliases for a potential change of your actual variable's content. So consider a language having preliminary data types, and if pointer P points to primitive data element, then any arithmetic operation on P produces a value that may be an integer. Okay, so if P points to an array, addition or subtraction leads to P somewhere in the array, that is P plus 1 or P minus 1, puts the variable P again in the array. And if P points to other array, then the impact of this would have to be dealt by the optimizing compiler. So if P points to one array, it's okay. If P points to some other array also, that has to be also dealt with. Sometimes it might even go out of memory area where you are trying to access a position which is not in your hands. So effects of pointer assignments are the variables that could possibly be used as pointers are those declared to be pointers and temporaries that receive a value is a pointer plus or minus a constant. So a pointer can point to, these are the possibilities, if there is an assignment S, a statement number, P colon equal to address of A, then immediately after S, P points only to A. Okay, after this statement, P points only to A. If A is an array, then P can point only to A after assignment of the form, P is equal to ampersand A plus or minus C, where address of A typically corresponds to address of the first element basically. Okay, we normally, I am not looking at it from a syntax perspective. This is simply A plus or minus C. So address of A of 0 is what we refer here as address of A. Another possibility is if P is equal to Q plus or minus C, and we know P and Q are pointers, then after this assignment statement, P points to where Q is already pointing to. Okay, so this is the next one. And if there is an assignment of the form P is equal to Q, then P points to what Q points to. Okay, so the next one is a pointer can also point to any other assignment to P. There is no object that P could point to. Such an assignment is probably meaningless. So P is, when you define a pointer, you have to make it point to some memory address only. So after any assignment to a variable other than p, p points to whatever it did before the assignment. Okay. Now alias computation, this is done using a data flow equation where you define in of b as ordered pair p comma a, where it is nothing but set of variables a to which p could point to at the beginning of the block b. Okay. So p comma a input basically means p is a pointer, p could point to variable a at the beginning of block b is the interpretation. We have a concept called as transfer function, trans of b, transfer function that defines the effect of block b. That is, block b will basically have a set of pointer assignments and pointer arithmetic. So what is the effect of this particular block will be defined using the transfer function trans b. It basically takes a set of pairs s of the form p comma a and produces another set t. So t could be union, intersection, or it could be a change, subtraction, whatever is possible, depending upon what gets created within a particular block b. Okay. Now the next one is trans b is computed for every statement, and trans b is the union of all the trans statements s. Okay. So trans b is computed for trans b means transfer function of particular block b, and that is computed by computing the individual statements transfer function and computing union of that to determine the blocks transfer function. So rules for computing trans of s, if s is equal to, if the statement s is p is equal to ampersand a, or p is equal to ampersand a plus or minus c, where a is an array. That is, you are simply having a array assignment to pointer p, or it could be an array with an offset. So in that case, transfer function of this statement s is nothing but all of the statements that is entering the block minus p comma b, such that any variable p union p comma a. That is, it removes wherever p was referring to already from the total available set of transfer statements, and it is going to simply add p comma a to it. So the previous ordered pair involving the first argument as p is removed, and it is going to add the new p comma a for all variables a available within a particular block b. Okay. And then the next alternate statement will be q plus or minus c for pointer q, and c is non-zero. C is a constant which is non-zero constant. So p is equal to q. So what should basically do now? P points to where q is pointing to. So again here I should remove all the earlier assignments of p, okay, and then include the assignments of p comma b such that q comma b is already there, because p points to where q is already pointing to. So here it says s minus p comma b such that b is any variable. So it removes all those and then adds p comma b such that q comma b is an s and b is any variable. So this is basically indicating that p points to where q is already pointing to. The next one is if statement s p is equal to q, this is exactly similar to the previous one, only s minus p comma b such that any variable b union p comma b such that q comma b is in s, either with a offset or not. I am simply looking at this as a ordered pair representation only, therefore p points to wherever q is pointing to already. So the this second statement and the statement here, the first one, are exactly same. The fourth one is if s assigns to a pointer p another expression, then you simply have to add that expression alone to the set and delete the previous assignment of p. And if s is not an assignment of the assignment to a pointer, then transfer function of s is equal to simply s. So it is not a pointer means you simply added. So this is basically done as far as the first statement is concerned, first block's first statement is basically concerned. So this is what, so these five rules are used for deriving data flow equation, and we define in and out of all the blocks as follows. So out of b is equal to trans b of in of b, and in of b is equal to union of all the out of p, where p is a predecessor block. And trans of s is defined as trans sk of trans sk minus 1 of trans sk, that is you keep on accumulating. So, you first compute the inner statements transfer function, use that to compute this, use that to compute this and so on. So, consider this particular example where we have 5 basic blocks and the first block is q is equal to address of c. So, this is the first criteria, the first condition. Statement S defines P is equal to address of C, where C is an array and C is an array or a pointer, what C is a variable, whatever it is, and Q is actually a pointer. Now, block B2 assigns address of C to P and it also assigns address of A of 2 to Q. Similarly, block B3 assigns address of A of 0 to P. And block B4 increments the pointer P by 1 and P is equal to Q. So, this is the last case. Okay. So, this is the P is equal to Q case. The other cases are the first and second options basically. Now, how do we compute the data flow equation? So, as we know, out of B1 is equal to trans B of in of B1. We know in of B1 is null. Okay. So, so in of B1 is null, so trans B1 of null. So, whatever B1 defines, that is nothing but out of B1. So, B1 basically creates only one statement here, which is Q is equal to address of C. So, Q comma C alone is a pair. Okay. So, Q comma C alone is a pair. Now, this B1 is given to block B2 and B3 respectively. Okay. This B1 is given to block B2 and B3 respectively. So, input will be Q comma C here as well as Q comma C here. So, what will this do? This is creating P comma A as one situation. So, output of this will be P comma A union Q comma C and output of this will be P comma C obviously because it is creating here. Now, Q comma C enters, but that Q is overwritten by assignment to A. So, it will be P comma C union Q comma A. So, let's just see that. So, P is equal to ampersand C replaces all pairs of P with P comma C and Q replaces Q comma A. So, out of B2 will be trans B2 of in of B2. In of B2 is Q comma C. So, out of that will be P comma C union Q comma A because P comma C means this is the new one. And Q already enters, Q comma C is what is getting entered here and Q comma A is what is getting generated here. So, therefore, these two will be, I mean, I will eliminate Q comma C and add Q comma A. So, in that angle, I can say out of this will be P comma C and Q comma A, trans is also same. So, the same thing is given to B3 as input, B3 creates P is equal to address of A. So, I have a ordered pair P comma A and Q comma C. Q comma C this is not eliminated because that gets generated. Now, these two is fed to B4 as input. Okay. So, P comma A, Q comma C, P comma B2 is P comma C and Q comma A. So, all the 4 are fed to as input to block B4. Block B4 simply increments P by 1. Okay. So, in that case, incrementing means A is an array, we already know that. From the example, A is an array, that is evident here. A is an array. We do not know anything about C. So, C could be a simple variable itself. Okay. So, this is the array variable. So, therefore, what we do is, when I say P is equal to P plus 1, it has to move within the array only. It cannot go and look at C if C is a constant. So, simple variable. So, it has to move only within an array. So, the definition of P outside this block will be only with reference to array only and not with reference to constant C. But of course, Q does not get overwritten here. And let us see that with a table. So, this is what is given here. And the table, this is fed as input to block B4. So, P comma A is retained, P comma C is eliminated because I have a statement there P is equal to P plus 1. P is equal to P plus 1 will basically override all statements involving the variables other than that being an array. Therefore, I have a p comma a here, and this will be q comma c and q comma a here. That is given as, that is retained as it is. So b4 output is this, that is fed as input to b5. Now b5 is an assignment of the form p is equal to q. So whatever was point q pointing to, p will also point to that. So p q comma a and q comma c is fed as input, that will be written with p comma a and p comma c as output. Now there is again a feedback. The feedback here is b4 is fed into b1, okay, b4 is fed into b1. So in the next iteration or next pass, what happens is out of b1 will be p comma a q comma c only, okay. So therefore in subsequent iteration that will basically change, but anyway output of b2 will be the same and output of b3 will also be the same. These will not change. Out of b1 alone will basically change to include p comma a also, because that is fed as input to, that is there is a loop from b4 to b1. So that is what we have here. So in the second pass, p comma a and q comma c is there. Other than that, the remaining information doesn't change. So you can have look, take a look at it here. P comma c, q comma a here. P comma c, q comma a here, that doesn't change. Only the block b1 alone basically changes. Okay, p comma a and q comma c. The remaining information remains as it is, because those block b3 has overridden. You have a overwriting there of q as well as on p, and block b4 is going to be anyway incrementing p, and block b5 will be a assignment of p is equal to q. So therefore, that is also not going to change. The remaining alone is going to basically change. So the in the second pass and the third pass there is no change at all. Therefore, this is the final result of my computation. Now, what do we do with this? How do we interpret this information? So p comma a, q comma c, p comma c and q comma a. So a is an array and p is a pointer. So p and a are aliases, q comma c are aliases, p comma c is also alias, q comma a is also an alias. So that is the result outside the block b5. So when you are going to change the value of a or c, you have to ensure that you could change it either through p or through a. If you change it through p, okay, this will also basically change. That should basically be taken care. Care should be taken such that it is not writing at multiple scenarios which it is not supposed to write. So you can use a to manipulate with the array. P can also be used, but p comma c is also an alias, so it might also change the value of that at the output of block b5. So you have to be careful on that. So this is basically used for live variable analysis, for dead variable analysis, as well as dead code identification, and reaching definitions can also be use this for computing which variable is going to be defined and which variable will be defined at a particular point in your data flow equation. So to summarize this module, we have looked at loop optimization, and we have looked at dealing with aliases and its impact on reaching definitions or live variable and dead variable analysis. Thank you.